Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the place to where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? This was the Gospel of St. John. Now let's hear from the Gospel of Johnny.
Your own personal Jesus, someone to hear your prayers, someone who cares. Your own personal Jesus, someone to hear your prayers, someone who's there. Feeling unknown and you're all alone, flesh and bone by the telephone. Lift up the receiver, I'll make you a believer. Take second best, put me to the test. Things on your chest, you need to confess. I will deliver, you know I'm a forgiver. Reach out and touch faith. Reach out and touch faith. Your own.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So we began the By This Way of Life Master Series a year ago last May with a six-week look at the very passage you heard from John 14 where Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes unto the Father except through me. Now that we're in the 11th six-part series of 12 before we finish at Easter, we're circling back again to that very passage, only from another angle, angle suggested by Johnny Cash himself, asking the question, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? Now, for many of us in the mainline church, that question about having a personal relationship with Jesus makes us about as uncomfortable as being asked, are you born again? In an era of personal pan pizzas and personal computers and personal trainers, the word personal suggests overly much the ability to control or have something do or someone do whatever you wish. And we certainly wouldn't want to apply that same idea to Jesus, like Jesus is our personal pet or personal assistant or servant. Yet, those people who come up to us, say, on a street corner, or who may be sitting next to us in a plane with their Bible in their lap, asking us that question, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? They're not likely trying to get you to turn Jesus into your personal pet or your personal servant either. So why does that question make us feel, well, so uncomfortable? I mean, those people who hold their Bibles and ask that question, they come from a conviction that Jesus is their Lord and Savior, that Jesus doesn't serve them, we serve Jesus. And in that, frankly, I share that conviction. I'm more than happy to say I have a personal relationship with Jesus in that regard. I may not always use that terminology, personal relationship with Jesus. I'll oftentimes say I have a personal relationship with Spirit or the Holy Spirit or with God. All means the same thing in my experience. My experience of God or the Holy Spirit always comes to me, feels like Jesus. So I have no problem saying I have a personal relationship with Jesus either. But what I do find makes me uncomfortable is the implicit assumption underneath the question oftentimes. As in, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus, or will you burn in hell for all of eternity for not having one? It is because of my personal relationship with Jesus that I become convinced that God doesn't throw people into hellfire for eternity for failure to have a personal relationship with Jesus. We have quite the ability to throw ourselves into hellfire time and time again, oftentimes through blocking any kind of personal relationship with God by whatever name. God is more likely focused on helping us out of the fires that we ourselves put ourselves into than that. So when somebody asks me if I have a personal relationship and yet carries with it that assumption about hellfire if I don't, I want to ask this person, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? Or is this something that Jesus told you personally? Or is this something, this assumption, something somebody else told you who claims to represent Jesus? Or oftentimes what I hear back, well, no, Jesus didn't tell me this, but it's in the Bible. Well, then I want to ask, well, why didn't you ask me if I have a personal relationship with the Bible then? Why bother with Jesus? But the Bible, that's a good book too. It's got a lot of good information in it. And in fact, the very passage from John 14 suggests to me something else that about our relationship. Jesus says, my Father's house has many dwelling places. Many dwelling places. He says elsewhere in John 10, I have other sheep that are not of this fold, and they're connected too. So my assumption, not only based on my personal relationship with Jesus, but on that secondhand witness through the Bible, also assumes that there are many paths to God, not just one. And while other people may not be lost apart from a relationship with Jesus, what I can say is that I am. That I am lost without that. That's my personal experience. And I suspect that those many paths, they resolve ultimately into one path that does look a lot like Jesus, but that's just a guess. Now, the other thing that people fail to realize oftentimes when we quote from John 14 is that when Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes unto the Father except through me, he's making this statement not to the world in general, but to his own disciples who are sitting there with him. He's looking at them. These are people, he's making the statement, in other words, in the context of people who already have a personal relationship with him. It's not a presupposition for a relationship. It's based on a relationship that already exists. Now, that seems like so much theological fine-tuning. Let me clarify with an analogy simply from marriage. I've been happily married to Melanie for 25 years. Exclusively. And the reason why is because, 26 years ago, out of my personal relationship with Melanie, it was so wonderful that I could not imagine devoting myself to any other person. And I hope that she couldn't imagine devoting herself likewise. There was some deep intuition that told me that this kind of love that I was experiencing would only become into its fullness, it would not come into its fullness if it was like an open relationship with many partners. It would only develop through relationship with one partner over time that constantly deepens. So I didn't, while I could imagine having multiple partners, that did not interest me, nor does it interest me still. There is that exclusivity that comes when we fall in love. And when we fall in love, that's when we say, okay, this is the path, this is my path. Well, the same way with Jesus. You fall in love with Jesus, you realize, well, I'm in love with this path. I don't want to wake up tomorrow with Buddha and the next day with Muhammad and the next day with Lao Tzu and the next day with Confucius. I can be really good friends with all of them. They all have some really great things to say. But ultimately, my heart is in one place. And that's all I need. In fact, it provides me so much more than what I need. I can imagine spending my whole life and never getting tired or running out or exhausting this particular relationship. Now, in the mainline church, we've been perhaps quicker than other traditions to recognize that there may be many approaches to God, not just one. But we've been slower than most to recognize or to affirm in a public sense that while there may be many paths, ours is truly with Jesus. And we love this relationship we're in, that we would be lost without this kind of relationship, that there it does matter to find some path, but find it and then you move on it, deepen it in that path. It can be the most wonderful path and journey in the world. But sometimes you find it's hard, you know, when you're in a context where maybe you're asked, you know, about yourself, that and the subject of faith comes up to say, I have a personal relationship with Jesus, or I am a Christian, or I go to church. If so, you're not alone. In fact, I have a confession to make. The week before last, I was at a conference in Phoenix on the Great Convergence, a bunch of ministers, and I extended that my time by a couple of days in order to go up to a place called Arco Santi, which is the place that makes those wonderful bells we offer our moderators as a gifts for thanking them for their service for the year each year. And I went up to Arco Santi in order to spend 2 full days on a personal prayer retreat. Over the course of that time, I spent about 20 hours of walking meditation and simply sitting quietly, listening and conversing with the Spirit of God, who I have come to know in Jesus. Yet in the middle of that retreat, I was introduced to a young couple from Los Angeles, and we were just kind of getting acquainted, and they asked me, well, what do you do in Omaha? You ever realize how hard it can be to as a Christian minister sometimes to say to people you don't know that you're a minister? I said I was an author. Well, it's kind of true. I mean, I write my sermons now these days, and my 4th book will be published by Abedin Press a year from now. So, but I must admit, that felt cheap. It felt a bit like I was throwing Jesus and you, quite frankly, under the bus. You know. But before you start hating me too much, let me just also say that I haven't done that in 15 years. In 18 years of ministry, that first few years in Arizona was kind of rough. But I still don't own a clergy collar to this day because I'm afraid that if I saw myself in the mirror, I'd realize I was a minister and freak out. Okay, so it's kind of rough. But starting in about my 3rd year of ministry, when somebody asked if I was a minister or what I did, I would just come out and say, I am a minister, and I have not veered from that ever since until the week before last, for whatever reason. I admit also that in those early years of saying I was a minister, I'd also quickly add the caveat, oh, but I'm not the kind of minister you think, and I'm part of this really cool church, it's really fun, and all this. But, you know, I've even stopped doing that. For the last 10 years, I just simply say I'm a minister, because, you know, I don't want to, I feel like if I'm making all kinds of caveats, I'm throwing other people, my brothers and sisters in Christ who may believe a little differently than I do, under the bus. And I happen to be very well aware that there are all kinds of Christians who believe very different things than I do that are living faith, a life of faith, more courageously and admirably and, quite frankly, lovingly than I often do. So nowadays, I just simply say, I'm a Christian minister, and if it causes them gastric indigestion, I'll consider that their problem and not mine. But partly out of penance to Jesus and to you, I want to offer my confession of faith this morning. Why I'm happy not only to have a personal relationship with Jesus, but to serve as a Christian minister, perhaps for no other reason, next time you're asked and in a revealing way to reveal your faith, you might be a bit more bold, knowing that even people like me slip up once in a while who should know better. I have a personal relationship with Jesus, and I'm happy about it because for me, Jesus, years and years ago, became more than a concept. More than simply a wise figure who offered some really good advice to us and the world long ago. No, I experience Jesus as a presence. As a presence that actually knows me better than I know me, is more aware of me than I'm aware of me, and who loves me beyond what even I love me. And as I mentioned a couple of weeks ago, I find that moving, but what I find even more moving is that the closer I draw to this presence, the more I love you and other people too. The more I want to love like Jesus loved. The more I even begin to love my enemies or people who consider me their enemy. So this love makes me more loving. And frankly, I can't describe how that works, that God could be consciously aware of you and I. I mean, the universe is a pretty big place, last I checked. I cannot make any kind of calculations that makes it add up that there could be a personal awareness there of you and I, let alone a relationship, let alone a relationship that can guide our steps through life and can love us. No, I don't know how it works. I just, in my experience, know that it works. And quite frankly, that's good enough. Because when push comes to shove, all we really have is personal experience in the end. In fact, that's another thing I love about having a personal relationship with Jesus. It beats the heck out of having an impersonal relationship with Jesus. I mean, if relationship is only impersonal with Jesus or Spirit or God or however you invoke this presence, then what do you have? All you have then, in terms to base your knowledge and your beliefs in, is what other people tell you you should know and believe about Jesus or God or the Spirit. You've got to constantly be taking the advice of others who apparently have had this experience apart from you. You know, how are you going to judge? There's a lot of people who have a lot of different things to say about God, but how are you to make up your own mind apart from personal experience? But what I also love about having a personal relationship with Jesus is that to say you have a personal relationship with Jesus does not mean you have a private relationship with Jesus. That actually this relationship is never private, even though it is personal. There's something about love that always wants to come out in the open, that kind of wells up within us like a fire within. And in fact, if we keep it down, it actually starts to lessen our experience of that. You know, if I told you I am in love with my wife, and yet, really, I never, ever talked about her at all. Or if you brought up, are you married? And I said, oh, no, I'm not. I'm an author. You would have grounds to seriously question whether I was really in love. Same thing when it comes to God. Love seeks relationship, personal, intimate relationship. You know, in the realm of quantum physics, they're finding some pretty interesting analogies there. Those quantum physicists, when they get down to the very smallest elements of matter, you know, beyond even atoms, into the protons, and then beyond the protons into the quarks, those little tiny, tiny bits of matter, they have yet to ever observe a single bit of matter in isolation to everything else. No matter how much they refine their experiences, they only ever observe a particle of matter at its tiniest form in relationship to another particle of matter. And this has gone on long enough that many scientists are starting to conclude that there's actually no such thing as a single particle of matter. That there's no such thing as a single unit. That it actually, when you reduce everything around us to its finest essence, even there, it's all about relationship. One thing only has existence in relationship to another. Well, I'm not versed enough in quantum physics to tell you whether that works its way out truly that way or not. But this certainly is the way it works with God. There is no such thing as a personal relationship with God without a relationship. Not only with God, but with others. When Jesus was asked, what's the single most important commandment? What did he say? There are actually two, and they are inseparable. You can't distinguish one from the other. They are that singular. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. It is impossible to love your God with your heart, mind, soul, and strength without loving your neighbor as yourself. And as much as we would like to think otherwise, it is actually impossible to love our neighbor as ourself in its fullness without loving God with heart, mind, soul, and strength. However we invoke that God, by what other name we invoke it. So how about you? Do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? If not, don't fear. Very likely you do, but call that presence by another name. If you don't, do not fear. Because if you're open to it, you are likely to find yourself turning a corner one day and discovering a presence that has been there with you all along before you were ever even slightly aware of it, who loved you far beyond before you turned your love to that presence. One of the things I love that's so great to me about the Great Convergence is that more and more people are awakening to a relationship with Jesus or God, Spirit, a relationship that they didn't even realize they had already. And more and fewer and fewer people are making a pretext for that relationship, fear of hellfire, what happens if you don't. People are discovering that the value of the relationship is the relationship itself. And they're beginning to be more free in expressing that relationship. So if you should find yourself asked by a street preacher or someone next to you on a plane carrying a big old Bible who says, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? I would suggest if you have found that relationship, you might try this response. Yes, I do. In fact, the Spirit of the living God that has been made known to me most fully in Jesus Christ my Lord has been revealed as someone who goes before me to show me the way, who goes above me to watch over me, who goes behind me to push me into places I may not necessarily go myself, yet who goes beneath me to uphold me and uplift me, who walks beside me to be my strong and constant companion, and who dwells inside me to remind me that I'm surely not alone, and I'm loved, loved beyond my wildest imagination. And out of my personal relationship with Jesus, it strongly suggests that you are loved this way too. Making this confession, we not only reach out and touch faith, but we discover that faith has reached out and touched us. And the only fire involved in the equation is not the fire of judgment and damnation, but the fire of purification and blessing. We discover the fire of God's blessing burning brightly upon us and within us, now and always. Amen.